Good afternoon and welcome to St. Aedan Parish. We extend a warm welcome to all who may be visiting our parish as we join in celebrating the sacrament of Holy Confirmation. In order to help preserve the dignity of our sacred worship, we ask that you please take this moment to switch your cell phones to the silent or vibrate mode. The presider for this liturgy is His Excellency Bishop Colacicco. He will be assisted by Monsignor Emmett Nevin and Deacon Jim Maher. I invite you to please stand to greet our celebrants in singing our opening hymn, Come, Holy Ghost.
Merciful God, that the Holy Spirit coming near and dwelling graciously within us may make of us a perfect temple of his glory, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, I too will take from the crest of the cedar, from its topmost branches, tear off a tender shoot and plant it on a high and lofty mountain. On the mountain heights of Israel, I will plant it. It shall put forth branches and bear fruit and become a majestic cedar. Birds of every kind shall dwell beneath it, every winged thing in the shade of its boughs, and all the trees of the field shall know that I, the Lord, bring low the high tree, lift high the lowly tree, wither up the green tree and make the withered tree bloom. As I, the Lord, have spoken, so will I do. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. To give thanks to the Lord, to sing praise to your name, Most High, to to proclaim your kindness at dawn and your faithfulness throughout the night. Lord, it is good to give thanks to you. The just one shall flourish like the palm tree. Like a cedar of Lebanon shall he grow. They that are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. Lord, it is good to give thanks to you. They shall bear fruit even in old age. Vigorous and sturdy shall they be, declaring how just is the Lord, my rock, in whom there is no wrong. Lord, it is good to give thanks to you.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, we are always courageous, although we know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord, for we walk by faith, not by sight. Yet we are courageous, and we would rather leave the body and go home to the Lord. Therefore, we aspire to please him, whether we are at home or away, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive recompense according to what he did in the body, whether good or evil. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Christ is a sower. All who come to him will live forever. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you always, the Spirit of truth, which the world cannot accept, because it neither sees nor knows it. But you know it, because it remains with you and will be in you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Your Excellency, Bishop Colacicco, I'm pleased to present to you the confirmation class of 2021. Jax Ayub, Eric Daly, Ava Fitzsimons, Michael Gallagher, Sean Gorham, Elizabeth Gazzino, Aidan Lee, Kira Lee, Caitlin Mahoney, Dylan Marzik, Ella Marza, Cameron McCauley, Evan Moran, Patrick Morrissey, Allison Nellis, Lily O'Mara, Megan O'Mara, Nicholas Panzarella, Kira Plaganos, Casey Pritz, Caitlin Purvis, Liam Reddy, Sean Sheppis, Elizabeth Schrader, Ella Tereska, Jamie Torsey, Aedan Toffa, and Peter Tienen. This is the class of 2021.
Thank you, Monsignor Nevin. It is an honor to be with you this afternoon to bestow the powerful gifts of the Holy Spirit on these young men and women. Please be seated. You know, in our everyday life, there are things that are always before us, things that we are so used to, that sometimes we pay little attention to them. Sometimes we even take them for granted. And that's a shame, because some of those basic things of our life are so very important that we should pay a little more attention. Even when we come to church, even when we come here to this sacred place where the Lord Jesus wishes to dwell, where we live, where he lives, where we live, as our neighbor, present in the Blessed Sacrament. There are so many beautiful things when we come into church that help us to focus our prayer. But this afternoon, I want to draw your attention to something that is always here, always right before you, and sometimes we don't look twice. I want you to look at that crucifix. You see that beautiful crucifix? And then ask yourself the question, why is it that the church always brings us to Good Friday? Why is it important for us as Catholic Christians that Jesus is still represented on the cross? Have you ever wondered that? Have you ever asked yourself that question? Good Friday was a historical event. We know it happened. But so did the empty tomb. Why are we always reminded of the agony of his death on the cross? The answer is very simple, as most truth is. It is to remind us of how much we are loved. The Lord himself said it, didn't he? No greater love than this, than to lay down one's life for one's friends. And as he always did, his words, his teaching, were always followed by example. And that's why that's important for us in living our faith. That our words must be accompanied by our deeds. So after saying those words, the Lord Jesus embraces the cross for us. So much does he love us. And to help us to understand that, we realize ever since Good Friday, the way we love now is different because of Jesus. It's not any kind of love. It's a very specific kind of love. It's a sacrificial kind of love. So for us, for love to be real, for love to be true, there must be some element of sacrifice, or it's not love. And my dear young people, all you need to do to understand that in a very concrete way is look to your parents. You see, they are examples of sacrificial love for you each and every day. And in ways that we sometimes don't think twice about and often take for granted. You have a home. You have food. You have clothing. You have an education. And all of those other things in your life that you just can't live without. You know what those things are. But these things are given to you. These things are provided for you because you are loved. But the reality is, not one of those things comes out of thin air. Every one of those things has to be worked for, earned. And they don't think twice about that in giving it to you because they love you. But all of those things require some element of sacrifice. That's why the love is true and real and beautiful and life-giving and good. This afternoon, I'd like to tell you about two people in my own life that were powerful examples of sacrificial love. I'd like to tell you the story about my Aunt Sarah and my Uncle Louis. When my Uncle Louis was a young man, he came to the United States from Italy, and by trade, he was a tailor. Now, we don't know too many tailors these days, do we? Tailors were people who made clothing by hand before machines took their jobs. But he was a good and talented tailor, and he found work in a factory when he came to New York. And in that factory, there was a beautiful young woman whose name was Sarah. She too came from a far-off land. She came from Russia. And Sarah was a seamstress. Again, someone who sews by hand. And Sarah was Jewish. They struck up a friendship, and they began to spend time with each other. And when my aunt told me the story about how they met, she said it in such a unique way that I've never forgotten it all these years. She said, "I saw in your uncle a good and virtuous man with whom I could build my life." Isn't that a beautiful way to put it? A good and virtuous man with whom I could build my life. And he was a good man. And he was a very virtuous man. And the source of his goodness and the source of his virtue was that above all other things, he was a very faithful Catholic gentleman. He loved his faith. He lived his faith. He practiced it. And my aunt, when they were just getting to know each other, she found that intriguing. She found it attractive. As they began to spend more and more time with each other, she saw all of these things in a very real and beautiful way. As they would spend their lunch hour together in the factory, she realized that before he would eat his small sandwich, he would bless himself, bow his head, and say grace. He did that every day at lunch. He didn't care who saw it, what they might think about him. He was just so grateful for being here in a place, a country filled with promise and hope for a good life. He was just so grateful that he expressed that gratitude in prayer. When they were dating, she realized Louis wasn't available on Saturday afternoons. He was in church. He went to confession so that on Sunday morning, he could receive Holy Communion as worthily as possible. Of course, Sunday morning, Louis wasn't available. You know where he was. He was at Mass, faithfully. every Sunday. She found that intriguing. She found it attractive. As time went on and their relationship got more and more serious, she realized that this aspect of his life was so defining as to the man that he is, that she needed to understand it better. She needed to see it. So she said to him, "Louis, can I come to Mass with you on Sunday?" They met outside the parish church, and for the very first time in her life, this young Jewish girl walked into a church. You can imagine. You can imagine what went through her mind when she saw all the things that we are used to and often take for granted, seeing them for the very first time. She had many questions. And it was the first time that she ever saw the beauty and reverence and prayerfulness of Holy Mass. Imagine seeing it for the very first time. Many questions. And he tried to answer them as best as he could. She began to come with him every Sunday. She was falling in love with him. And she wanted to spend as much time with him as possible. But something else began to happen. As she came Sunday after Sunday and listened to the scripture readings and watched, just watched Mass, not only was she falling in love with my uncle, she began to fall in love with the Lord. She began to fall in love with Jesus. And she said, "Louis, bring me to your priest. I need to talk to him." He did that, and soon afterwards, she began instruction in our faith. She was baptized. She received her first Holy Communion. Like yourselves, she was confirmed. And soon after her confirmation, they were married. Now, it's a lovely story about their courtship, her conversion. Where's the sacrifice? Where's the sacrifice that made this a true and real love? And it was a true love. It was a holy love. And there was sacrifice. You see, on Louis' side of the family, my side, my people, my blood, there were some people in my family that did not accept Sarah. First and foremost, she was not Italian. How would Louis eat? That was a very important discussion. But I could tell you, she became the best Italian cook in the entire family because she loved him. And she taught herself what pleased him, and she perfected it. But in addition to that, despite the fact that she became a Catholic, despite the fact that she was baptized, among some members of my family, she was referred to as the Jew. It was the first time in my young life, I was about your age, that I had really experienced firsthand the hurtfulness and the ugliness of prejudice. And it was very confusing for me because the people who said it were people whom I loved. And the person it was directed to, I certainly loved and admired. On Sarah's side of the family, because she converted, because she was baptized, they never spoke to her again. And the home in which she lived with her family, she was no longer welcomed. The door was closed, and it broke her heart. You see, the love that they had for each other, the love that they had for the Lord Jesus, became a shield to protect them from the hurt, the ugliness, the disappointment of all of those things that were coming at them every day. Every day. The love they had for each other, the love they had for our Lord, became the foundation upon which they built their life together. And they had a beautiful marriage. But every day they had to face the reality that others did not accept their love. Where did they find the strength? Where did they find the courage? You know, in today's first reading, the Lord said that he was going to take a branch from a cedar, right? And do you remember from the first reading, where did he plant that branch? It was on the top of the mountain, right? You remember hearing that? You don't plant a seedling on the top of a mountain, do you? No. It would not survive. The wind, the sun. But the Lord said, I will plant it at the top of the mountain, and it will thrive. It will thrive. Why? Because anything worth its weight is so by God's grace. Their love was a sign, not just for themselves, but for those around them, and particularly for me. I'm standing in front of you this afternoon because of their example, because of their sacrificial love. You know, where did they get the strength to deal with all of that in their life? It was the gifts of the Holy Spirit, these gifts that you studied, these gifts that you know. They're much more than ideas. These gifts are real. They're very real. They're very powerful. Because sometimes we feel like that sapling planted on the top of a mountain where things are against us. Things are so against us that it's impossible. But by God's grace, by the gifts of the Holy Spirit, these powerful gifts, we are able to get through anything that life puts in our path that gets us off the path that Jesus wishes us to take. He will give us what we need. He will give us everything we need to be faithful, to thrive, even in those moments where life is difficult. These gifts of the Holy Spirit, which you know well, enable us to face the world head on, because we do so with God's grace and help, not just ourselves. I loved on Sunday mornings when they would come by and pick me up and bring me to Mass with them. I loved going to Mass with my aunt and uncle. I would learn from them. I would just watch them and be so moved by their devotion, their prayer. They were forming me. I loved especially when we receive Holy Communion and go back to our pews, kneel down, and enter into our Thanksgiving prayer and watch them and realize that what happens on this altar has to be true, has to be real. I see the effect that it has on the life of these two people whom I admire and love. I began to think like that. Their example, just watching them, increased my faith in the presence of the Lord in the Eucharist. Their example, their sacrificial love, watching that each and every day, enabled me to be able to hear the Lord's call and to have the courage to say yes. And I really am standing here in front of you in part because of them. And I thank God every day. These gifts are powerful. These gifts not only form you, they not only change you, they not only strengthen you, but the people around you who watch, and believe me, there are people who are watching, and they become intrigued, and they're attracted, not by the way you look, but by who you are, what you are, what you're about, where you're headed. When you came into the world, when you were born, your parents and godparents brought you to church to be baptized because they loved you and they wanted to give you the gift of faith. And at your baptism, you began your life with the Lord, He with you. They made promises in your name. You were infants, you were babies. But now in a few moments, you're going to make those very same promises your own. And I know you understand them because you studied them in preparation for today. But it's my hope that your I do to the questions that I will ask you not only come from here, but that it also comes from here. As a sign of love for the one who loves you more than you can ever imagine. And if you should feel yourself planted on the top of a mountain with everything against you, don't fear and be courageous, because that's when the gifts of the Holy Spirit kick in and you see the power of God working in you. So my dear young people who are about to be confirmed, please rise. And in a nice, loud voice, please respond, I do, to the questions that I will ask you, but I'm going to also ask you, when you respond to this profession of your faith, that your eyes be fixed on Jesus on the cross. That you keep your eyes fixed on Him. And if you do that, not only today, but every day of your life, if you keep your eyes fixed on Him, no matter what life puts in your path, you will be able to deal with it, conquer it, live with it, because you will know that He is with you and you are with Him. So, my dear young people, do you renounce Satan and all his works and empty promises? Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death and was buried, rose again from the dead and is seated at the right hand of the Father? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who today, through the sacrament of confirmation, is given to you in a special way, just as He was given to the apostles on the day of Pentecost? Do you believe in the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? This is our faith. This is the faith of the Church. We are proud to profess it in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. My dear young people, will you please kneel? Will your sponsors rise and place their right hand on your right shoulder?
Dearly beloved, let us pray to God, the Almighty Father, for these, His adopted sons and daughters, already born again to eternal life in baptism, that he will graciously pour out the Holy Spirit upon them to confirm them with his abundant gifts, and through his anointing, conform them more fully to Christ, the Son of God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who brought these your servants to new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, freeing them from sin, send upon them, O Lord, the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete. Give them the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and fortitude, the spirit of knowledge and piety. Fill them with the spirit of the fear of the Lord. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated and prepare for the anointing. My dear brothers and sisters, please rise. And let us humbly pray to God, the Almighty Father, and be of one mind in our prayer, just as faith, hope, and charity, which proceed from his Holy Spirit, are one.
For our church, that its leaders will always reach out to youth and champion their rights and role in our church, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our government officials, that they will show the moral leadership and courage to stand up for what is right and not what is popular, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all God's people at every stage of life, may we cherish the wonder, purpose, and responsibility of every age, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our parents and teachers, that they will be rewarded for their patience and kindness, may we become strong Catholic adults as a result of their example. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who will be confirmed this year, that confirmation will not be an end of their Catholic education, but a transition to a greater role in our parish and church. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our youth, especially those present, that we will accept our responsibility to serve God and our church according to our own special calling. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us offer our own needs now in the silence of our hearts. O God, who gave the Holy Spirit to your apostles and willed that through them and their successors, the same Spirit be handed on to the rest of the faithful, listen favorably to our prayer, and grant that your divine grace, which was at work when the gospel was first proclaimed, may now spread through the hearts of those who believe in you. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Good job.
Dearly beloved, let us gather together our petitions, praying with one voice, as our Lord Jesus Christ taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen.
Please be seated. I would certainly like to take the opportunity to thank Marie Gartner. She has been the head of our program for 28 years, and she's done a great job once again, particularly under these very difficult circumstances. So thank you, and also to Tris Quinn, her administrative assistant, and to all of our confirmation teachers, among which our Deacon Jim Maher, now with us in his 25th year, and we'll be celebrating that opportunity in the very near future. And all of our confirmation teachers may not be with us right now, but we are grateful for you, particularly for being so flexible and persevering over the course of this very difficult year. And finally, to our parents, it may not seem so long ago that you brought them to church, and the celebrant looked at you and said, you will be the first teachers of your children in the ways of faith. May you also be the best of teachers by what you say and do in Christ Jesus our Lord. So continue to do your best to be good role models to them, to be good teachers to them, and join with the sponsors and us to continue our young people's faith journey.
Well, your pastor was so generous and gracious to thank so many. We should thank him for being such a good shepherd. So we thank you. Before the final blessing, I'd just like to draw your attention to my crozier. Every bishop has a shepherd's staff. And when this crozier was given to me on the occasion of my ordination as a bishop, it was because it has special significance. You see, this is the crozier that the bishop held when I was confirmed. This belonged to Bishop Joseph Pernacconi, who was when I was your age, larger than life, a hero, an idol, and I am so humbled to be able to hold his crozier now. And every time I use it, I pray that I could be just a portion of the good and holy bishop that he was. But in addition to the fact that he confirmed me, when my Aunt Sarah asked my Uncle Louis to bring her to his priest, he brought her to a young father, Joseph Pernicone. And it was he who instructed my aunt, baptized her, and married my Aunt Sarah and my Uncle Louis. So every time I use this crozier, I am reminded of the sacrificial love upon which I try to build my own life each and every day. But because this happened, because I hold his crozier, I can't help but think that perhaps among the young men who were confirmed today, that one day maybe one of them might hold this crozier. Among the young ladies who were confirmed today, perhaps the bishop who receives your final solemn vows in religious life might hold this crozier one day. The church needs good and holy priests. The church needs good and holy religious sisters. They come from good and holy families. They come from good and holy parishes. It's my hopeful prayer that among some of these young men and women, this is not the last time you see this crozier. Please rise for the blessing. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing. May God the Father Almighty bless you, whom he has made his adopted sons and daughters, reborn from water and the Holy Spirit, and may he keep you worthy of his fatherly love.
Amen. Amen.
May his only begotten Son, who promised that the Spirit of truth would abide in his church, bless you and confirm you by his power in the confession of the true faith.
Amen. Amen.
May the Holy Spirit, who kindles the fire of charity in the hearts of disciples, bless you and lead you blameless and gathered as one into the joy of the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Let us go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Let us all join in singing our recessional song, The City of God.
Awake from your slumber, arise from your sleep, a new day is dawning for all those who weep. The people in darkness have seen a great light, the Lord of our longing has conquered the night. Let us build the city of God, may our tears be turned into dancing, for the Lord our light and our love has turned the night into day. We are sons of the morning, we are daughters of day. The one who has loved us has brightened our way. The Lord of all kindness has called us to be a light for his people, to set their hearts free. Let us build the city of God, may our tears be turned into dancing, for the Lord our light and our love has turned the night.